Ministers with beneficence and welfare work as well. 4. To meet the introducer and guarantor who indicate the way to attain Tao to me. It is very likely that, in the previous lives, we did charitable services together, or we celebrated together in the same religion. So, in this life, when Tao is available, we can help each other out and practice Tao together again. So time is ripe for Tao due to our divine affinity. D.I. What impact does receiving Tao have on me? As we mentioned before, and like the old days when hermits had to leave their families to receive Tao through meditation and self-cultivation, Tao, at the present time, can be received in a way that is applicable and conforming to our practical needs. We don't have to give up our lifestyle in order to attain Tao. By the grace of God, Tao is intended to be delivered to the public at all levels of occupations and around the world, rather than being limited to a privileged group of people. The impacts that receiving Tao can have on our daily life are summarized as the following. A. Receiving Tao creates no conflicts with any religions. Tao governs the universe, including all human beings. It existed before the formation of any religions. It is concordant with all religions, in the sense that religions preach the awareness of conscience and the pursuit of the truth. We don't need to give up our religion in order to receive Tao. On the contrary, by receiving Tao, we will have further understanding of the truth. The conscience becomes our ultimate guidance due to the variations of cultures, customs, backgrounds, legislation, and value systems. It is difficult to find a universal guideline for all of us to follow in our daily life. In receiving Tao, the main commandment is to act by our conscience, the true self, rather than by literature. We should be sensitive to the conscience, rather than be familiar with the laws. C. We will voluntarily keep the promise made while receiving Tao. Through receiving Tao, we are not offered conscience or true self, but merely the opening of the door to a wisdom and mercy. Therefore, we restore the heavenly principles inherent in us, and strengthen the power originating from our conscience. There is no external force that makes us keep the promises and commitments that we made when we received Tao. The only force comes from the guilty feelings that result from our misbehaviors, which reduces the mistakes we make. Deep practicing Tao can accommodate our worldly affairs. The fulfillment of practicing Tao and conscientious awareness does not have to be accomplished in a temple or church. It is not required to abandon worldly belongings or relationships in order to attain the ultimate truth. Each individual can still have his/her family, career, and schooling at the same time. As long as we keep in mind the basic guideline, we should have our practicing Tao and getting closer to our divine self. We will make a better world by improving ourselves first after we receive Tao, by realizing the true self and what we are. The feeling of joy comes to us. The improvements on the quality of our spiritual life will affect people surrounding us. By interacting and working together in Tao, we will make the world better with lower crime rate and less pollution. The wish of Maitreya will finally come true to turn the world into God's kingdom and make people all live in harmony. D.I.I. What can attest the validity of Tao Dao, due to its completeness and generality, regulates the totality of all beings. Many people, after receiving Tao, with their wisdom, faith, and devotion, realize that Tao is the fundamental principle that governs all things. They comprehend the truth of the universe not only through literature, but also through daily living and nature. Their faith in Tao becomes strengthened and they move forward in their spiritual life. However, for people who haven't or just received Tao, Tao can be confirmed through revelations. Anyone who has received Tao with the front door open shall die peacefully. One proof of this is that for those who have received Tao and died, their bodies remain soft and their faces vivid. Since the soul leaves the body through the correct exit, the corpse can actually remain uncorroded for a few days. With the most advanced modern science and technology, it is still difficult to explain this phenomenon. However, it is a fact that cannot be denied. This has happened before in some religions, but very rarely. For people who have received Tao, this kind of testimony is ubiquitous, unless they have committed serious sins and corrupted their own mind. This can prove the soul has reached an ultimate harmony. Be being the superintendent of the things on earth, human beings are nonetheless weak. Since birth, we are subject to unpredictable accidents and natural disasters. There have been many people who encountered danger, used the three treasures with faith, and got away from the danger or reduced the damage to the minimum. Testimonies of this kind are numerous. The above two mentioned are rarely heard of and difficult to believe, but they are the immediate security given by God once a person has received Tao. Thereafter, with each individual's faith, wisdom, and the accumulation of good deeds, one will come to know the truth more and more. It is up to you to experience the value of this treasure. I hope you will have the opportunity to receive Tao, experience it in your life, achieve ultimate perfection, and realize eternity. Rubucdial.html
先天大道简介中英对照
http://www.tao-library.com/category/category6/c63006.htm Introduction to Tao
先天大道简介
Introduction to Tao
中英 对照天天大道简介一和为天天大道二。 道与我有什么关系？三求道是求什么？四求道对我有什么好处？五具备什么条件才可以求道？六求道对我的生活有什么影响？七道的宝贵有什么印证？一和为先天大道，先天大道又简称道。我们若仔细的去观察，心窍开悟之后，就可发觉宇宙间森罗万象皆是杂而有序，而自然界万事万物的运转也都有一定的法则。各天地人是万物的真主宰，就是道。道乃在天地生成之前即已存在，故曰先天大道。道者理也，理就是真理。在天地人万物未生以前，道即已存在，而道能生天生地生人生万物万类。在天地人万物毁灭之后，道不会毁灭。道因为无去无来，不生不灭，乃代表着宇宙间亘古不变的真理。道的本体也就是宇宙自然的本体，在混沌未判之初，宇宙间只是一团灵妙理，无天无地无人，也没有语言和文字，所以我们实无法以任何语言文字或思虑来形容它。故大道无名强名曰道，我们也是勉强用到这个名词来代表它。在天地万物生成之后，早就能贯穿于宇宙万事万物之中，使一切的自然现象均能呈现和谐有条不紊的运转，这就是道的妙用。道大理为，我们虽然无时无刻离不开道的本体和妙用，却又很不容易去认识它。因此在两三千年前，各教圣人应运出世，各化一方，针对当时天时地利及众生的根器，留下千经万典，传下诸多去恶从善的修持法门，同时也让芸芸众生认识了冥冥中宇宙万事万物均有一个真正的主宰，或称为上帝，或称为造化，或称为天主，我们称其为道或无生老，均是一名而同义。我们对道有了深一层的认识和体悟之后，就会了解天地间实无一物不是道之本体与妙用的合一。因此道虽然涵盖各大教门的经义，为千门万教的总源头，确实不局限于宗教的领域里。而上帝或老也不只代表着一切宗教的最高信仰中心，更是天地万事万物万类的根本源头与最高主宰，及宇宙间永恒不变的真理之道。所以我们今天有机会了解什么是先天大道，不只找到了各大教门的最高信仰中心，也找到了宇宙的根本源头与最高主宰，更能对宇宙至高无上的真理有一个初步的认识。道之真义，在先天之先不为 天，在后天之后不为后，即大上有可量，即为上有可止，为道即大不可量，即为不可止。故所以大无不包，为无不入，无所不贯，无所不通，无所不彻，万彻了天地人万物万类，万彻了三十三天外，万彻了千经万典，万彻了千法万法，万彻了千教万教，万彻了千佛万祖，贯彻了我之一身，此乃显天大道宝贵的真谛，人人必须知真觉，亦即是人人与我，我与人人良心之行也。此乃万众一心，万国一家世界大同，此先天大道之宝贵也。二，道与我有什么关系？道的宝贵在于它大而无所不包，细而无所不入。天地生成之后，道贯穿于天地万物万类，使得日月星辰之运转各有其时，四时之交替，万物之消长各有其序。而最宝贵的是各天地万物的主宰，同时也是我们人一生之主宰，曰性理，使得我们不学而能看，能听，能吃，能动。因此我们不只要探求天地间的治理，更要回头认识我们身上固有的真理，故先天大道即是性理真传。道的宝贵并不在于它有什么神秘稀有或特殊之处，而是在于它平时但我们却时时刻刻离不开它的本体与妙用。我们反观一下自身，就会发觉我们身体的结构是非常精密和奥妙的。我们轻轻地握一下手，就算是这么简单的一个动作，其中所牵涉到的所有关节物理作用、能量化学反应、神经系统资料讯息之传输，及脑部分析判断和命令之下达，以目前全世界的科技知识和文明水准也无法一一表达出来。但是我们做出个动作的能力却完全不因个人知道上了程度的差异而有任何影响。无论是学识多丰富的学者，或是目不识丁贩夫走卒，无论是成人或是刚出生不久的婴儿，都可以轻而易举地做出的动作。人人与生俱来，不学而知，不学而能，无增无减的良知良能，就是主宰我们一生的道。我们由学习而得到的知识和才能，有忘记的时候，有疏远的时候，而道的本体和妙用，不用学习，不用思考，大而能主宰宇宙的运作消长，小而能主宰我们一生之视听言动。我们有而不知其有，用而不知其用，却又无时无刻不能缺少它。的不增不减，但自具足一切我们身上固有的道，因为就在我们身上，又称作自性老。我们了解了 个主宰天地万物的道，在我们身上就有，它的作用不应受到我们赞美或否认而有任何增减。无论种族、肤色、国籍、宗教、信仰或贫贱富贵，均无分无别。因此，我们能求得先天大道，不只找到了宇宙的根本源头，也找到了不生不灭的真我。不只认识了宇宙，也认识了我一生的真正主宰。不只追求到了宇宙之治理，也找回了我身上本有的真理与良知良能。先天大道的根源是在我身上，原来固有的是我由先天带来的良知良能，即是我的良心。我的良心即是天心，天心即是道心，此心无形无相，即是真空。真空之一妙，空而不空，空中妙有。妙有者，生天生地生人生万物万类之大本也。妙有者，万灵真宰也，主宰天地人万物万类之真主宰，亦即是主宰我之一身。故曰道在无身，一切万能。道离无身，此身百无一能。先天大道如此宝贵，乃人人必须追求之道也。三求道是求什么？静心观察我们所存在的这个宇宙，我们往往会赞造物主的神奇。自然界每一刻皆有无数的事物在同时运转，而其整体却又是那么协调。我们身上的这个真理不也是一样吗？每一分一秒，我们身上皆有无数的生化反应、物理作用等同时发生。道的妙用分布在我们身上，不用学习，不用思考，其作用虽成千上万，合起来却只有一个自我，一切有条不紊，自然而成。道在无身，运用自如，在眼能视，在耳能听，在口能言，在鼻能闻香臭，在身能运用行动做事，此即道在我身之妙用。所以我们了解了道不止主宰着天地万物，更主宰我们一身。宇宙根本源头最高主宰于我一身主宰，并非二也。道的本体无形无相，我们肉眼看不到它，手也摸不到它，但它却无时无刻不再发挥其妙用，更进而随着天时及环境而发展出语言文字经典及造福人类的文明，此即是我们良知良能之作用。一般人不了解道在于我们自身的本体和妙用，只模糊意识到它的存在，便以灵魂代表它，我们称其为自性老。因其没有生灭，也不会毁坏，我们也称其为真我。此真我乃是最富足、最圆满、最光明、最完美、永恒不朽的。现在我们来生一看，看得见摸得着有形有相的肉体， 能不能代表我把一个人生命中不同阶段的照片拿来比较，我们就可发觉面貌是无时无刻不在变化的。我们一般均习惯以相貌认人，但相貌却不是永恒的。我们的肢体也不是真我。某些人不幸失去了一只手或一只脚，仍是好好的活着。我们的内脏呢？现在科学昌明，其自己能把动物的心脏成功地植入人体。我们不能因此说的人不是他自己了。就算头的脑细胞从我们一出生就开始不断地在坏死减少和变化之，因此有形有相的肉体只是真我的一个工具而已。肉体虽然看似真实，却无时无刻不在改变之中，不拘束十年又变成一堆黄土，因它不是永恒的，我们称之为假我。对于真我和假我有所了解之后，我们也就可以了解我们为什么要求到了。如今我们非常幸运能有机会求得先天大道，求得的就是三宝。三宝简单明了，但也博大精深，其内容在求道时会详细解说，现在只简单的提出两点。首先，求道就是直接点出了真正永恒不休的真我，也就是良心本性的发。在物质文明远较精神文明昌盛的今日，假若迷失真我，我们的人生将又如行尸走肉。若是认假为真，更是为我们为了盲目满足假我而做出害己害人的事情，造成自己在世时与死后的灾祸。因此求道启发了我们内在本的真我良心，真我假我协调融合，使我们的人生不论存没都是平安喜乐自在充实而有意义。其次，求道也就是开启了我们身上的正门，又称良心之门、智慧之门、慈悲之门。各门非常的重要，当我们要离开一间房子时，自然由大门离去。如果此门无法开启，而被迫从窗户或阳台跳出时，就可能会摔断腿。我们的肉体就像一间房子，真我灵性就像是房子的主人。当有一天肉体要毁坏时，真我灵性若不得正门而出，被迫另寻旁门，其恐惧与焦虑是无法形容的，这也导致了死后的痛苦与不安。因此我们可以发现到，绝大多数的人临终时，其肉体皆显现山僵硬恐惧无助与挣扎之相。求道就是开启我们的生来死去之正门，也就是通天大路。因此我们今天很幸运能求道，求得三宝，打开灵性通天之正门，可以让我们找回真我。 认识我自己身上的道，自然以良心作为待人物之准则，使人生更有意义，更进而解决生死大事，得到超生了死的保障。百年之后，回到我们的来故家乡，所以先天大道又是回天之道。先天大道之宝贵，即是千经万典不足一点，此点打开玄关正门佛门，天堂大陆一步直超级的永生之道。此点宝贵，超佛越祖，超经越典，超越天地。得到这一点宝贵，他是诸经之师，诸法之王，诸佛之天地之，故曰超生了四极的永生，不毁不灭之先天大道也。此乃即是人人原来固有的，必须返回天之道也。四求道对我有什么好处？我们今天很高兴能有个机缘求道，能够开启良心之门、智慧之门、通天之正门，这是第一步。这宝贵的道还能带给我们终生受用不尽的福之意，离苦得乐，人生在世遭受种种之苦恼，就其根源皆起因于迷失了真我。求道首先就是让我们认识人人身上固有的道，找回我们本有至真至善至美具足圆满永恒不休的真我，在日常言行之中发挥真我，使我们一举一动皆能合于理，至于至善，自然不会受周遭的人事物所左右，我们的心也就不会患得患失。心为一身之主，我们既然在心境上有所提升，自然不会与邪恶之事相感应，则不相随心转，还可以改变命运，趋吉避凶，朝向光明，使我们得到真正的喜悦逍遥自在。二堕地难，自有人类文明以来，道的真意便代代单传独授，其没落贯穿了早期的主要文明，如中国、印度等。奈何近百年来人类受物欲所逼，在空前繁荣的物质文明中逐渐迷昧了良心，甚至竟将制造威力极大的杀人武器。回顾数千年人类历史，在近代短短数十年间便发生了两次世界大战，无数挑战，伤亡无数。滥用科技文明，同时也损害了自然环境，造成大气臭氧层之破坏，全球性气候的改变，人心之变，感造了天灾人祸连连。人类已为自己酝酿了一个空前的浩劫，因此上帝洪恩慈悲，特将大道普传于此，以挽救良善。求道以后，我们时刻存着道心，以良心待人处事，当遇有人力不可挽救的灾祸时，只要诚心使用三宝，必能灾避劫，逢凶化吉。此事验证甚多， 不生美举。三超生了四人生，又如一段苦乐香餐的旅程，遭受生存竞争、衰老、病痛、死亡等困苦，人皆难免。而人间种种欢乐又往往是短暂易变的，尤其当旅程结束时，终就成空，归宿渺茫，更不禁令人凄独怅惘。是以智慧者又见于此，乃以超生了死，追求真实永恒的人生意义，为人生至高之目标。古代先修后的，因此古人为求超生了死，尽毕生之力苦修苦行，仍难以仿得名师达成心愿。如今大道普传，先走后修，在求道过程中，天命名师一指，开启了我们通天正门，先赋予超生了死的保障。我们得到以后，认识了真我，以真我为主宰，远离邪心妄念，让我们的心念言语行为，无论待人处事，皆合于良知。百年之后，真我灵性自然返回故家乡，永享平安喜乐。四成圣成贤求道，也就是为我们种下一个成圣成贤的正因道种。只要我们以智慧慈悲心境灌溉它，它必然萌芽开花结果。在此功利主义弥漫的黑暗时代，大道乃是光明的灯塔。求道修道，不仅让我们能够独善其身，更是我们有机会可以兼善天下。求道之后，只要我们时刻抱着道心良心，在日常生活中真诚实践道的精神，不计个人得失荣辱，努力使周围每一个人都可得享道的好处，让道的光明照亮每一个角落，尽其一生精进不懈，则在世即成就圣贤事业，归天之后，必证圣贤果位无疑。先天大道的宝贵就是天道天命，天命就是三曹名师，名师一点玄关开，打开正门佛祖来，天堂飞在我身外，天上地下我都在。此乃先天大道的尊至贵至宝也。先天大道，天命宝贵，三曹名师这一点妙至极矣，非是在言语文字相声音可得，非是在千经万典上的，非是在讲经说法上的，非是在世指变通上的，非是在博学才能上的，非是在才高八斗上的，以上皆是生死法对待法，非是超生了死脱对待了生死之法也。此次级的先天大道妙用妙能的宝贵，其妙极矣。此者是无师智，此智是妙智妙慧，此智此慧是我本来固有的，由先天带来的，亦即是在找回来天地人万物万类未生以前我的初心，即我良心天心道心老心也。先天大道之妙， 四妙之鬼妙，不容言，不学而知，不学而能。亦即是先天带来的先知先觉妙用妙能，此知此觉此能此用，不用言语文字声色，不用思想，不用念头，不用言听事动，而生天地人万物万类。生天地人万物万类之后，这天地人万物万类时可分妙，也离不开其妙用妙能，故曰万灵真主宰也。设若天离开先天大道之妙用妙能，则河汉星斗乱序，日月无光，亦不能轮转，则阴阳二气不能流通，万物万类世界的众生，人人皆不得其生存。设若大抵离开先天大道之妙用妙能，这金木水火土不能相配，则险象丛生，山崩地裂，海水枯干，亦使万物万类世界的众生人人不能得其生存。设若人离开先天大道之妙用妙能，则寸步难行，眼不能看，耳不能听，口不能言，总之全身不能动作，一百日之后成了一堆臭骨臭泥土。此乃先天大道妙用妙能的宝贵，妙至极矣。设若觉悟认识先天大道之妙用妙能的支持而实行，即是天人合，以天人一体治理，觉言妙不容言，不是死后成佛，当体即佛矣。故曰如来佛如是佛也。此乃的先天大道修先天大道之好处，物具备什么条件才可以求道，求道既然能够带给我们终生受用不尽的好处，我们今日能有机会求道，会不会显得太容易了？事实上，我们能得闻先天大道，首先要感谢上帝的恩慈，将自古不兴泄的大道普传于此，使我们有机会得此天之道。另一方面，我们本身也必须具备足够的条件，祖上有德，根基深厚，佛缘成熟，才能够顺利求道。此外，我们必须向宇宙至高无上的造物主上帝发一个良心愿，此愿可归纳为三个要点：一、得道以后，愿以铭记并实践道的精神，也就是日常生活所思所言所行，皆愿以良心作为依归；二、得道以后，愿以能力所及助周围需要我们帮助的人，愿以多了解道的意义，并让更多的人蒙受天道的福祉；三、得道以后，绝不将求得的三宝告知任何人。三宝必须在庄严的求道过程中，天命名师传授给我们才有真实意义，若由我们泄露给其他人，则不但毫无意义毫无效果，我们自己也违反了天律。的良心愿合乎人人本具天赋的良知良能，所以我们人人 都能够做到。真诚实践良心愿，也必须滋润我们求道时种下的智慧慈悲心境之正因道种，使它顺利萌芽开花结果，才不至虚度这千载难逢的求道修道良辰。值得一提的是，我们能顺利求道，原因之一即是沾了祖德的光，是故上天开恩，只要我们修道有恒，则我们的祖先也有机会可以求道超生得救，我们的子孙亦得应地，对父母祖先敬大小，这是最好的机会。只要具备以上条件，则无论任何国界种族宗教信仰的人都可以求道，欲求得先天大道，脱出轮回之苦地狱之灾，世间的穷通受忧鳏寡孤独生老病死苦，而返天堂永享天伦之乐者，必须我有得遇六万年良辰佳期的幸运。我本人心地善良，我有先天根基深厚，也就是我本人前世做的功德善事很多，此即天缘。我本人祖先有功德做善事，自己祖上有德，我目人遇到银宝师度我得道，此佛缘已至，也就是前生我们一同做过功德善事，或一同有修过宗教，今生遇天道降世，一同得道修道，此乃佛缘已至。六，求道对我的生活有什么影响？现今正值上天恩开，先天大道普传，拯救良善之时，不普传方式皆以方便善巧，与众生起机为原则，因此求道不会对我们正常的生活造成任何负面影响。这与以往许多人苦修苦练，甚至出家的修行方式有很大差别。也正因为如此，先天大道能在日新月异的现代，适应社会的各个阶层，传布到世界的各个角落，使人人皆有共沾天恩的闻大道的机会。关于求道对生活有什么影响，我们又以下几点来看，以与任何宗教没有冲突。道代表着天地万物及我们一生之最高主宰与真理，不止在各大门创始之前，甚至在天地未生以前，道就已经存在了。因此，任何教门，只要其教义是追求真理及实践良心，就不会与道有任何冲突。事实上，不止宗教，只要我们以探求真理的角度去观察，则自然界万事万物皆能与道吻合与印证。若我们原有某种宗教信仰，求道将不会造成任何抵触，也不会使我们背弃原有的信仰，反而让我们对真理的探求有更深一层的体认。 二以良心经为最高规戒，每一个人生活环境中的文化习俗、时代背景、法律条文及价值观念都不完全相同，因此没有任何一个具体的规戒或条文能够适用于所有的人，所以求道后的规戒着重在我们每个人真我良心之实践，由真我良心主宰自己，而不是在经典之背诵上及律法之钻研上下功夫。三不照良心愿行，有何后果？很重要的一点，求道并非从外在加以我们良心与真理，而是借着开启我们智慧慈悲之门，找回我们身上固有的真理，让天理良心自然流露。因此求道后，所有真修实行之人皆是自动自发的。师父，求道后若我们不照良心愿而行，并非将出现任何外力来强制我们遵行此愿，而是将受到自己良心的谴责，由真我良心督促自己而自然改过向善。四圣凡间修真我之实践，并不局限于教堂或寺庙之中，因此现今大道普传并不要我们家舍业到深山古寺之中修炼，而是在不影响家庭工作学业之正常情况下圣凡兼修，在日常生活中时时刻刻一言一行皆能以天理良心为依归，就是真我之实践，务由提升自己而兼善天下，求道后会使我们生活更充实，心灵更和谐。而更重要的是，我们每一个人尽一己之力，借自身之提升，影响周遭之人事物，继而会成一股力量，在这举世天理良心日趋沦丧之潮流中，匡正人心，力挽狂澜，如此必能早日实现先天大道普传之宗旨及弥勒佛的原慈大愿，化污泽的人间为人间净土，化纷乱的世界为世间天国。七道的宝贵有什么印证？道是宇宙的至高真理，它的作用贯穿了天地万物万类，更是我们一生之最高主宰。真正了解了这一点，我们就会体认到道是随时随处可以被印证的。许多贤贤得道之后，发出了大诚心、大信心、大智慧，真修真行，皆能参悟道。不止在各教经典之中可以印证道，其实在任何时间空间、万事万物，我们之一身甚至一草一木皆离不开道的本体和妙用。体认至此，自然能发出永不退转之道心。而尚未求道或刚求道者，则需借助于一些具有形象看得到、感受得到的印证，以奠定初步的信心。一任何人只要有求道， 经过深赞天命之名师点开玄关正门，传授三宝者，无论其功德高深为末，死后皆是身软如棉，面色如生，灵性由正门归天。东不品师，下不腐臭，甚有多至数日不变，一香满志者。目前的科技文明和医学知识还未进步到足以解释这种现象，但却无法否认个事实的存在。这种现象虽曾出现在某些宗教中，但极其罕见而珍贵，而求道之人除信道不笃于反道败德者，不敢定论外，其余则比比皆是。肉身既显似瑞香，足可证其灵性已登善境，当无疑问。二人虽不为万物之灵，其实是很脆弱的。自从生在个世界上，就难免天灾人祸的威胁，甚多以求道者，在遇到人力不可挽救之危急情况下，诚心使用三宝，皆能大事化小，小事化无。这种例证多得不可胜数，无法在此一一例举。以上两点虽然极为宝贵，但却是任何人只要一求道，借着上帝的天命宝贵，立刻就可以得到的保障。此后就随个人的诚心智慧及对真理之实践，而有或深或浅不同的体验了，如人饮水，冷暖自知。希望各位具有善根，有机会能得闻大道的先生女士，皆能入宝山而满载而归，皆能求道而同真善境。
Introduction to DAOI. What is DAOI? DAONMEII. What it is in DAOID. What do I get in RECIV and in DAOV? What do we need to receive DAOVI? What impact does receiving DAO have on MEDII?What can attest the validity of DAOI? What is DAO? Observing the cosmos and all the living beings consciously, among all the earthly activities and phenomena, we will find the existence of the laws of nature. There is a supernatural origin which guides all the operations happening across the galaxy, the earth,and the human beings. We call this source Dao. Dao existed before primordial time, and even before the universe was merged. It is the origin of the world, and it thereafter nurtures all the creatures and beings. Since it is unchangeable and does not evolve with time, it is the ultimate truth.It is what all saints and sages throughout human history had been searching for. The essence of Tao is the foundation of nature. The law or the power that existed before the universe was formed is beyond description, because there were no civilizations nor creatures, let alone languages.Since it cannot be applied any name, we simply call it Tao. After the world was merged, along with the mutations of the universe, we see the harmonious actions as exhibited in seasonal changes, rhythms of time and tide, and the balance of the ecosystem. We also find some conformity of human nature across various cultures. These prove the laws of nature. This is the extension of that original Tao when it is substantiated and materialized. It merged into everything that is with and within us. Now that we know Tao is present universally and yet difficult to be recognized, there have been prophets and preachers trying to make us know and understand the origin and the truth of life through various teachings and literature since the beginning of civilization. They were scattered around the world throughout history. As a result, great commandments were taught to disciples and goodness and badness were differentiated. These teachings varied, based on differences in culture, background, timing and the level of each individual's comprehension. However, they all tried to express and transmit to their descendants, this creator and chief of the universe. It is God, or what we call Tao. As we get to know it more and more, we will realize that the essence of Tao and its effect covers every existence without any exceptions. Tao is actually the headwaters of all religions. It embraces the essence of all the preaching and teachings. And yet, it is superior to the system of belief. It is the nature, the universe itself. Tao or God represents the highest authority and power of nature. It is also the headstream and superior to all. It is the unchangeable principle. Understanding Tao allows us not only to discover the center of all religious belief, but also to communicate with the origin and the highest power of nature. We will then be able to relate ourselves to the truth of the universe. To probe further, Tao existed before the formation of all, yet it was not anterior, which means that the creation was embedded in it. Tao emerges into the creation, yet is not posterior, which means that it is not thereafter limited. Among those created, however large, they can be measured, however small, they can be detected. It is only Tao that cannot be measured of its immensity nor detected of its existence. Therefore, it is larger than the largest and leaves nothing excluded, and yet it can be smaller than the smallest and leaves nothing not penetrated. It is ubiquitous. It merges into and governs all. It is in charge of the space, the earth, human beings, all the creatures, and all existences. It penetrates and regulates the entire universe. It is the source of all the scriptures, sutras, as well as dharmas. It encompasses all the religions, and it is what makes one a Buddha or a saint. It is the single chief of all. And, above all, it is in charge of each individual too. It is the divine self. This is the true meaning of Tao. We should get to know it this way and rediscover our own invaluable treasure. So, to practice Tao is to revive one's own conscience as well as everyone else's and to act upon it accordingly. Then, all people can be of one spirit, all nations can be in peace like a family, and the great harmony will come true. How precious does I-I-D-A-O-N-M-E the significance of Dallas in its immensity and ubiquity. Its mightiness guides the universe to carry on with changing seasons and evolving creatures. The countless aspects of the natural phenomena seem so capricious and yet really in order and in cycles. This almighty being also resides in each of us. It is the divine self, the natural quality of a person. It enables us to see, to feel, to taste, to hear, and to move without learning. While we research the ultimate truth in the universe, we should turn in upon and see into ourselves to discover that divine self. We will find the rules that govern the universe also comply with the way we are. Tao is not something too far to reach, nor too mysterious to comprehend. It is nothing particular, but has to do with our daily lives. We cannot do without it. Every movement we make, in order to see, to touch, to feel and to think, is associated with Tao. Consider how many wonders are hidden in our body, how delicately our physical functions are carried out. For example, when we shake hands, the components involved would include the coordination of joints and muscles, the chemical reactions of energy, the transmission of information through nerve systems, and the actions occurring in our brain such as issuing orders, making judgments and analyzing situations. Even with the most advanced technology and the highest level of knowledge we have developed today, we cannot completely reconstruct such a function. Yet the ability to perform such a simple movement is there for all individuals, regardless of the level of a person's knowledge and his/her being a grown-up or a baby, a scholar or an illiterate. Theses are the kind of abilities we come equipped with naturally, without learning and being taught. It sits within us and is in charge of all. It is Tao, never diminishes nor inflates. Worldly knowledge acquired through learning can be forgotten. A gymnast can abandon his/her techniques and a musician can lose his/her skills without practicing. The essence of Tao and its extension are always in charge of the macro universe, the nature, and the micro universe, the human being's self. We are associated with it unconsciously since the first day. Because it encompasses the whole nature within us, we also call it native self. Tao is within and surrounding us. It needs not be worshipped nor debated over. Because its existence is unconditional, regardless of race, color, nationality, religion or status. It is impartial and stays constant. In receiving Tao, we not only find the origin of the universe, but also the divine self. We get to know the highest power in the universe as well as the genuine nature in charge itself. We discover the ultimate truth of the cosmos as well as the integrity of ourselves. Recognizing that the laws which govern the universe also govern us makes us be able to return to our true nature. To probe further, the most essential concept in Tao is that we all possess it intrinsically. It is the wisdom and ability we were born with without learning or practicing. It is one's conscience, which is like the spirit of God, the divine and immortal nature. It is invisible and intangible. For this reason, we call it genuine emptiness, which means that to be really empty, it goes beyond emptiness and can therefore have marvelous existence in it. Marvelous existence is the foundation for the sky, the earth, human beings, all the creatures, and all existences. With omnipotence, Tao is called Great Lord of all beings. This almighty being is not only in charge of the entire universe, but also in charge of oneself. So the proverb is, Tao is within self, which is the drive of all one's abilities. A physical body without Tao is useless. This is the treasure that we should all realize and fully explore. What it is in Tao, when we look around the world, we admire the miracles and wonders of nature. Countless things change and move simultaneously every second, and yet in order and in harmony. So do our bodies. Countless biochemical reactions and physical functions occur concurrently within our bodies. Without learning and thinking that come subjectively, the thousands of activities that happen within us are the extension and action of Tao. And altogether, it is one single self. It functions naturally and automatically without the need for our intents to be involved. This is the effect of Tao within us. Tao is not only in control of the universe and nature, but also in charge of every human being in his/her own actions. In other words, it is the same source that governs us as well as everything else. Tao is invisible and intangible, but it has been working out its magic before day one. Thereafter, languages, cultures, religious scriptures, literature, and civilization were developed. They all originate from Tao functioning within us. People don't realize it is Tao that has been residing and working within us and have used soul to represent the confusing and yet irrefutable being. Because it is eternal and intangible, we also call it true self. This true self is the most abundant, brilliant, and imperishable being. Let us take a look at our tangible body and see if it can be the true self. We know the pictures taken throughout one's life show different faces and expressions. We recognize people by face, but our looks change and are not permanent. The handicapped, with impaired arms or legs, can also lead a complete life. One with a transplanted animal heart is still a human being. Even our brain cells keep decreasing and changing every second from the moment we were born. Therefore, the physical body is only the interim residence.